order at 6:33 p.m. It is determination of a quorum and that the agenda was properly posted. It was properly posted and we do have a quorum. So we will do the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
At this time, we'll take nominations for Chairman Pro Tem for the June 20th, 2016 Village Board meeting.
I nominate Harvey.
Second.
Any other nominations? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Thank you. Number four, public appearances. Public's opportunity to speak about any subject that is not a specific agenda item. Bob, you're here for, okay. Number five, discuss and consider the minutes of the regular Village Board meeting of June 6, 2016.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion second to approve the minutes as presented. Any further discussion? On hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Discuss and consider the minutes of Special Village Board meeting of June 15th, 2016.
Motion to approve.
I'll second with one change. The day should be Wednesday, not Monday. Any other changes? All in favor say aye.
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 Oops.
Opposed?
Harvey did.
Harvey did.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carried. Do we have any presentations for the board this evening?
No, we do not.
Okay. Unfinished business. 8A, identify, discuss, and prioritize village ordinances requiring updating and revising.
For the meeting in July, we've got a couple of ordinances, two from MSA, or suggestions from MSA in terms of approval, allowing staff or the engineer to approve reductions in letters of credit, and we also have the infamous gunpowder and firearm Nerf gun ordinance. So there'll be a couple that we'll bring back in July.
Thank you, Lee. 8B, discuss and consider proposed agreement with Colonial Club.
Okay, Bob Powers is here tonight, and what I included in your packet was proposed final draft of the agreement. The primary revisions were made to Article 2. Bob and I talked that, and I pointed out that the board wanted to try to have some more objective criteria, and he provided that for us. And Bob, if you want to just have a seat, then we can. There was that change in Article 2, and the only other change was to add the name of Melody Riedel, who is the Director of Services, will be the person in charge of the services and activities performed per the agreement. So this is the same document that you had last time, except for the changes made to Article 2, and we'd open it up for questions.
Are you okay with the document as it stands?
I'd like to clarify on number two, the one-on-one case management. Well, actually, it's number one and number two combined. We have 1.5 on-site at Taylor Ridge and 1.5 at the Bank of Sun Prairie for a total of 3 hours mm-hmm. per week on-site. And that actually is, should it, we do about 3 hours Cottage Grove work that includes Taylor Ridge, the bank, and then there should be a third piece that's either they are still coming to the cottage to our place in Sun Prairie, or it's on the phone. So it wouldn't be a dead straight 1.5 at each of those places. It'd probably be split up like an hour, an hour, an hour for a three. So in addition to Taylor Ridge and Bank of Sun Prairie include, you know, on-site at the Colonial Club and via phone. Does that make sense?
Yeah. To me, it makes sense.
Minor, we're changing.
Yep.
It's still, you're still providing service, and that's what's
right.
important.
And just a couple of comments on some of the other ones. We'll be on number three, the noon meals. We are, you know, just beginning looking at 2017 funding from the county, which primarily is the funder for that program. Right now, it's still has not been approved by the Older Americans Act at the federal level. We've never had a problem with it before. It eventually gets there. I wouldn't anticipate that it doesn't this year, but you know, that's one of the glitches with that funding. It's federal, and we've got to wait for them to pass it.
Should we add deliver 1680 noon meals, and that it's subject to federal fin- or not financing, but
federal funding? Sure.
And is the 1680, are those noon meals in Cottage Grove?
That's both Cottage Grove and on site at Colonial Club. It's a combination. The majority are here. Clarify that number, but number four, just for your information, we hope and we're anticipating that we'll be able to improve transportation. We have received our new minivan with two wheelchair accessibilities. Our current minivan doesn't have any wheelchair accessibility. And then come August, we'll be getting a brand new bus, which will allow for transport of 11 passengers and two wheelchairs. And then we'll still have a backup. So we'll be adding, you know, to our transportation pool, giving us more options for potential transportation. And then the only other thing I was gonna ask was, would it be helpful if we had, so Melody oversees all of these programs that you're seeing here, nutrition, transportation, case management. Gail is our lead case manager. Would it be helpful maybe at mid-year to have Gail visit and give you a report of more of the details of what she's dealing with in case management situations? I mean, it's always a lot more complicated than I ever think it is. And I didn't know if it might be helpful for you to hear what she's doing at some point during the year. We'd certainly offer that up as a possibility.
I think that would be helpful to us as a board as we go, because we'll be looking then at the budget late, not too be too much beyond that. So if we could arrange something like that, I think it would be good.
Yeah, I agree.
So maybe we'll try to do something in July or August, and who would I work with to get that on the agenda? Matt? Okay. Number six is just a little different. I should explain that too. RSVP is the Retired Senior Volunteer Program. That's out of Madison. They do transportation specifically for medical appointments only. There is a volunteer in Sun Prairie who coordinates all that. Because of the lack of funding RSVP is getting, it appears that we're going to have to take that program on ourselves, which may mean hiring if we can't find a volunteer to do that. And she's doing, right now, between 70 and 80 rides a month between Sun Prairie and Cottage Grove and maybe Bristol Burke, but it's quite a bit. It's quite a bit, so. That's it for me. Any other questions I can answer?
I guess I have one for Lee and or Matt. The liaison between the village and Colonial Club is village administrator?
Yep.
Okay.
Harvey, that's in Article 4B.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions from the rest of the board? I would move approval of the proposed agreement with Colonial Club with noted changes. Is there a second?
A second.
Motion and a second to approve the proposed agreement with Colonial Club with changes as discussed this evening. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Thank you, Bob.
Thanks, Bob. Yep.
Good night. Appreciate it.
New business, 9A. Discuss and consider renewal operator license applications for licensing year July 2016 through June 2017. In the packet was a list of those licensees. Does anybody have any questions?
Looks like, Chief, these are all vetted through background checks and everything.
Yes, officer. Comstock did them and they all got approved and were recommended.
Okay,
great.
I saw it. I just wanted to like to hear from you guys.
Yeah, thanks.
I would move approval of the renewal operator license applications for July 2016 through June 2017. Is there a second?
Second.
Motion and a second to approve renewal operator license applications for year 2016-2017. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. 9B, discuss and consider new operator license applications for licensing year July 2016 through June 2017.
Chief, these little look good too as well?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. I'll make a motion then to approve the new operator license applications for July 2016 through June 2017.
Second.
Motion and a second to approve the new operator license applications for licensing year July 2016 through June 2017. Any further discussion? I'm hearing none. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. 9C. Discuss and consider Municipal Services Building Fund expenditure requests. In the packet was a memo from Public Works Director J.J. Larson with a report from the Utilities or the Facilities Committee.
Sorry. I see the memo. There's just under $93,000 remaining in the municipal service fund, the building project fund, and there was a list basically of requested items to purchase before closing out that fund. Chief Sean and I pulled together that list. Public Works Committee approved it, as you can see, not to exceed $18,000, but the conversation essentially went to not closing out the fund without having a final assessment, kind of a second set of eyes on the building before closing out the project fund. There's one issue essentially that somebody was concerned with and didn't want to close out the fund yet, but they did approve the requested items.
That issue being like the ceiling and caulking on
yep.
On the
face
portions
of
the
exterior, you
know. Yeah. Yeah, and they basically just wanted us to work with MSA on just doing a a thorough inspection, see if anything else is out there, since there are funds available to go towards that purpose, and if they're not utilized, it would go towards the next year's bond payment. So,
yeah, I'm just curious, the MSA costs to have them take kind of a look at the building.
Right.
What is that? Do you have an estimate or?
Not yet. Yeah, we're. I think Mike wants to just take a, you know, they'll take a look, and they need to understand what the actual scope of this would be. So we have to work with them on determining what that would, what level of service it would be. So we're going to bring that back to the Public Properties Committee, and then we'll bring it back to the board. So.
Okay.
So just so I'm clear, one person's opinion or their board opinion, or where's the stand?
It was the whole committee voted.
The whole committee
voted to not close the fund out yet. That was the stipulation. They approved requested items, but stipulated that we don't close out the project fund without a final assessment.
Yeah, I think that's a good question by John, and I'd be curious before I move forward on having him say look at that. For what I hear is caulking, I mean, unless there's something more glaring than that, I.
Yeah, we've got experts on staff,
right?
The building, right?
Yeah, and the building contract was, it's not in MSA's name, right? That.
Right, the SDS, there. But, they're, for all intents and purposes, they're closed out, and there were aspects that we weren't happy with. So
that's a subject for a potential closed session.
Yeah.
To really explain the whole aspect of it.
But Kyle, we're just looking to get an estimate of what those costs and what the scope of that inspection would be, and we would take that back to the committee and then back to the board.
Okay. Yeah.
Was the building ever check before occupancy? I'm assuming it was.
Yeah, our Tom Beacon.
Okay.
Yeah.
Tom did. Okay. Figures. Okay. And he didn't obviously know anything on the building.
Mm-hmm. But he's looking at it for specifics. You know, the.
He's looking at the electrical and all the heating and all these other things.
Yeah.
HVAC.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just so it's clear, what's the purpose of the TV in the conference room?
That's my first question.
It's a smart TV, so it's essentially so we can put up presentations on the TV.
Okay.
Rather than lug in the laptop with the
Okay.
projector and things like that.
Okay.
And all the connectivity that it will have with tablets and laptops.
Okay.
And things like that. So
Okay.
it would replace a projection.
Okay.
And then air conditioning in the rec programming space? I mean, is that really... Hey, Sean. Because I've looked at the area, and it's rather large. I don't know how you'd cool that space.
We've had actually three estimates of people come in, and it is possible to cool that space.
Okay.
And it's definitely going to affect our programming over the summer on what we can and can't do in there, because it's just a big box that's...
Yeah, of heat.
So, yeah.
And do we have requests for summer activities or interests if we did have air conditioning?
Absolutely. Especially our adult fitness would suffer. We wouldn't be able to do it in the summer. And also we're trying to offer some senior fitness stuff too that...
You definitely could do without cooling it. How much interest is there? I mean, is it 5 people, 10 people, 30 people? I'm just curious.
We
don't know.
Our classes are full, what we're offering. So we're basically offering right now, for this session that runs through June, we're offering, there's four different classes that are full at 20 persons each. And they're also looking, we'd like to be able to go past June into July and August, and we feel that those will fill as well.
What kind of revenue does, roughly how much revenue does that bring in?
Per class, it's roughly about $300. That's revenue once everything's paid.
I guess I'd look more as a service to the citizens.
Sure.
You know, if we break even, that's good. If not, then it's fine.
Too. I was just looking at more like the AC specifically for that space, for those programs, so it would pay itself over
a period
not too
time.
Long.
So, yeah. No, I get where you're going with that.
Mm-hmm.
Any further questions, discussion? And I would make a motion to approve the additional municipal services building fund expenditures as presented in the memo this evening. Is there a second?
Yeah. Amend that to say
sure.
Subject to getting a MSA bid for doing walkthrough.
Okay.
And I'll second it.
Okay. Motion and a second to approve the municipal services building fund expenditures as presented in the memo tonight with an estimate from MSA. Is that what you said, Kyle? Okay. Any further discussion? On hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carried. 9D.
Thanks, guys.
Discuss appointment of alternates to village boards, committees, and commissions.
Well, I put a memo in the packet along with a copy of the ordinance that was adopted by the board in January of this year with the intent of answering this question. And Alex was talking about the potential of adopting language that said, you know, any of the board, village board members may serve as an alternate, and which is fine, but I think that given the current language is what I would recommend to stay with, in the sense that we have always had a process where the village president gets an opportunity to appoint people as alternates, and I think keeping that process makes sense. And then if that you run into a problem on a every once in a while if you have an issue and you need an alternate, I mean you get someone appointed. And I think that the other thing is that then the people who are alternates, it gives them an opportunity to follow committees, commissions, and boards that they are alternates to. So I'd recommend not doing anything and keeping the language that we already have.
I was going to say, I'm assuming that means then we don't have to change the ordinance as it stands.
Right.
I think that the ordinance and the language is good. I think rather than officially name somebody an alternate, I think that they were trying to have a possibility of having any of the village board members step into a meeting so we have quorum. And is there a way of writing that to where the president still is the one that says, well, this is the village member that's covering to make sure we have quorum so we don't miss meetings?
Historically, where this all came from or what the issues have been in the past is at some point you had a couple of different village presidents who didn't appoint people to boards, committees, or commissions. And then, so now we made sure that the board has the right to appoint if someone hasn't been appointed. And we also specifically then gave the village president the right to name an alternate. And the problem with trying to define it or to say, well, because you just, it seems like sometimes the exception becomes the rule that, you know, the alternate always is there. So that was why I thought that if we kept it the same and the village president, you know, could always appoint more than one or two alternates. I mean, they could appoint
when is that process completed, I guess? Because if they're going to go into a meeting tomorrow night.
Yeah, April or May, they should. April, the village president gets elected. It takes office the
third week
in April, and usually the appointments are the first meeting in May. And the way we've written our ordinances, the appointments of the old members continue until May 1st, I think, or until their term ends.
Couldn't the president in July or whatever, the alternative's off on vacation, to your point about quorum, that he or she, president, could then appoint an alternate right prior to meeting to cover the quorum?
Well, this is how it could work, I think the best, and that is if you know you're going to be on vacation in July, and you're going to be missing, you know, a couple of meetings, and you go to Jack and you say, well, we have to make sure there's an alternate for this meeting or this meeting. So I think that then at least alerts the board to the fact that someone's not going to be there and that they might need an alternate, and that could happen at any point during the year.
Then we could leave it as is. It still covers your issue.
It doesn't. I mean, circumstances happen where somebody can't make a meeting a couple of days ahead of time. You're not going to have plans.
Yeah. Again, I think it's the scenario still plays out that the president can slot somebody in.
It sounds like it needs more time than that. What about when you just said May or whatever, what if it, because most of the committees obviously have two or three of the members on this board already, what about naming the alternatives at that time, the rest of the village board?
Well, that's when they should. That's usually when the alternates are named.
Right, but I mean, just for on every committee, take the remaining board members that aren't on there and start making a practice to name in order alternative one, alternative two, alternative three.
Yeah.
So then if those two individuals can't make it, it's already named that alternative one as so-and-so.
Yeah.
It's a little bit more work up front, but it kind of prevents from meetings not happening when people are flying in from out of town.
Right.
Yeah,
I mean, that could just be part of the process. And I mean, when Jack gets back, we can, if the board elects to keep the ordinance the same, just say, look, you know, here's what we may want to do for the July meeting is to make sure that we have, you know, we make appointments of the alternates and for all of the committees, commissions, and boards to do it that way.
Yeah.
I'm fine with that.
I think that'd be good.
Yeah.
Okay.
We don't have to change this order.
Yep.
Well, every once in a while, I like to suggest that we not do something. So.
9E, discuss and consider resolution 2016-5, transportation funding for local transit systems. This was.
Yep. Was there anything?
So the Just Fix It Wisconsin is a group that's trying to create awareness with municipalities, legislatures, and citizens in the state of Wisconsin that some type of maintenance and further construction maintenance replacement of transportation in Wisconsin has to be created, something sustainable. The funding for transportation has gone down in the last several years quite substantially. Fees have remained pretty flat, and the answer in the legislation right now is to borrow for it, which is a short time fix, because several years from now all the fees that we do collect are going to end up just being put towards debt payment. So the committee or group Just Fix It Wisconsin is trying to create awareness to have the legislators look at creating some kind of sustainable plan going forward on what to do with the condition of the roads in Wisconsin. The league is behind this as well. And they have reached out and are asking municipalities to pass this resolution. And then if you so choose, I will send it to the legislatures and along with other municipalities that are doing the same. And that's kind of the first step in the whole process.
Is there a second page to this? I only see one page in the packet.
What's the resolution?
It's a two-page resolution.
Yeah, there's background on one page. And then there's, oh, there'd be a signing. Should be a signature page.
It should be a signature page, and I don't see that.
It should be. Whereas, and then the now therefore.
Yeah, that's not in there. Right?
Yeah. I haven't seen it.
You know, we have the first page of the document, but not this page.
Okay. Yeah, it looks like it didn't scan in.
Probably got sucked through.
Yeah.
I'll take it over there.
I mean, obviously, Deb, this is just a resolution that's saying, as a municipality, we think this should be something that the legislature should do, look at.
Mm-hmm. It doesn't obligate the village to anything whatsoever.
Right. No. I got that from the opening page.
Expressing opinion.
And clearly, it's a problem.
Clearly.
Yeah. Opening the credit card every time the road breaks is not a good idea. I don't have a problem with that.
Is that a motion?
Yes. Motion.
And I'll second. Motion and a second to approve Resolution 2016-5, Transportation Funding for Local Transit Systems. Any further discussion? On hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Number 10, reports from village boards, commissions, and committees. Public Works and Properties Committee's update on Bonnie Road property.
Essentially, at the last Public Works and Properties Committee meeting, Sean and I gave a presentation on the future of the Bonnie Road building. But the committee made no final recommendation or anything to the board. Essentially, trying to get exactly at what my homework was. It's going to be to put actual costs to keeping the building versus selling the building. The needs will be further discussed in front of the village board after we bring it back to committee with actual costs attached of either working out a deal with the salt shed and or replacing the salt shed at a different location. Some kind of storage pole shed and the movement of the village compost collection. So essentially the direction was to get, or as best as we can, put some hard numbers to the costs of keeping it versus selling it. So there was no formal recommendation.
And along with the side of the cost to keep it, they recommended also discussing with MSA the same building assessment. So we can do that same scope of services to see what it would cost for them to look at that building too, to see if we were to fix it up and sell it or fix it up and keep it, what would those costs be? What would actually need to be?
We have alternative number three, which would be to sell it as is.
That was part of the discussion too.
Yeah, that would be, there would still be costs of potentially, you know, moving of the salt storage, the compost, and finding some additional storage. Okay. So
unless we can get easements in salt storage,
mm-hmm.
with we haven't had anybody. Obviously, people know that the building's empty. We haven't had anybody approach the village on it, even though.
Not me.
Okay.
Any other questions for JJ?
And the office, to clarify, I mean, the office is empty, but there's some larger equipment, depending on the season, that...
That was part of the presentation Sean and I gave.
And they'll do that presentation here, too. Yeah. The committee just wanted to fine-tune it a little bit first.
Will that presentation include numbers then, JJ?
As much as reasonable. I mean, that's what, I mean, some of the things it may be hard to quantify, I think, but we will as best as possible. I mean, selling versus cost of moving aren't, but, you know, different services and things that were laid out in our presentation are kind of hard to quantify, but yep.
Okay. We're obviously paying for it right now. So.
And we are utilizing it right now. It's not empty, and we do use it for compost collection, so there's equipment stored in there right now, mm-hmm. things like that, and that was part of it, and then how we can continue. And that was one of the directions, too, was to begin to show how we could utilize it right now so that it can help determine, you know, when folks can actually see what we can do with it right now, even without having it a formal recommendation to do anything with it, that could be part of the decision-making process, too. So there are areas where we can clean up around the village and utilize that space right now. So
I'm assuming then we would also have alternatives. If we were to sell the property, whatever we're using it for currently, as you said, we have citizens that are dropping off their mulch and stuff there right now. We'd have direction then from Public Works and what those alternatives would be, correct?
Yep.
Okay.
And those are the things we can put hard dollars to. Yep. So.
Yep. Okay.
Thanks, JJ. 10B, Utility Commission. Update on Gaston Road right-of-way permit.
Tonight, this is going to be a two-part presentation. The first open for the open session and then a brief closed session. Following the receipt of the recommendation from the PSC, it was our expectation, and it was in the language of the PSC letter, that the town and the village continue to work on a negotiation of the right-of-way agreement. Instead of that, the town drafted their own version of the right-of-way agreement, met in closed session, came out of closed session, and then presented it to the village and said, essentially, take it or leave it. We assumed that this was the starting point for any comments or discussion that we might have. So I sent a letter to their attorney that said, I'm in the process of putting together the comments that I received from the Utility Commission, which met the day after the town met. And her response was, well, I'm not sure what you're doing that for, because essentially it is take it or leave it. And so I've contacted the PSC, and they're quite interested in the fact that this seems to be the way it's being handled. And we were concerned that this was going to be the case. So right now we're putting together our comments that, and those will be sent to the PSC, and hopefully they'll be able to break this deadlock.
Thank you. 10C, Plan Commission. Discuss and consider proposed amendment to Village of Cottage Grove zoning ordinance to amend parking requirements for multifamily residential, senior residential, indoor storage, and vehicle repair land uses.
Yeah, the Plan Commission made a recommendation for a few changes to the parking regulations within the zoning ordinance, lowering the number of spaces required for a studio or efficiency multifamily unit. Currently, the ordinance does not differentiate in terms of parking requirements between senior housing or non-age restricted housing. So we're recommending adding a separate set of criteria for senior housing, which would be requiring two spaces for a senior unit that has three bedrooms or more, or one for a smaller unit. And some minor changes to two of the commercial categories, vehicle repair and maintenance. Instead of basing it on square feet, we're recommending on basing the parking on the number of service bays. And for indoor storage and wholesaling, instead of basing it on, again, square footage, we base it on the number of employees.
Uh,
Aaron, is this leveraging some of the best practices that are out there or recommendations from local governments? Or
yeah, we based it basically on three different things. We took an audit of comparable communities and kind of saw where we had outliers or not. We also looked at some census data as far as, you know, number of cars available per household, things like that. And then we also got some information from MSA, from the ITE parking generation manual. So three sources of input for these.
Kyle, have you, you're obviously in this space and see a lot of these. Does this, these seem reasonable to you?
Yeah, they kind of lightened up on parking for seniors, yeah. Which is a good thing because they obviously don't have as many cars. And currently, it didn't, kind of what Aaron said, it didn't separate. Mm-hmm. So they were kind of holding them to that two car kind of limit. So this kind of, we looked around to Sun Prairie and surrounding communities, and this is kind of what the Plan Commission came up with.
Okay. So.
And it's been approved by the Plan Commission?
Yep.
Just consider. Yep. I'll make a motion then to update the, or accept the agreement or the amendment to the Village Cottage Grove zoning ordinance as stated here and presented.
One second.
Motion, did I hear a second?
Yeah,
Kyle. Okay. Motion and a second to approve the proposed amendment to the Village of Cottage Grove zoning and ordinances to amend parking requirements for multifamily, residential, senior residential, indoor storage, and vehicle repair land uses. Is there any further discussion? On hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Community Development Authority. We met last Monday. All of the items on the agenda were discussed. We had a good conversation with chamber president about a proposed study using UW Extension for a study of economic development in the village, studied land uses and various things like that. Greg Johnson from Ehlers was here to present to the Community Development Authority various aspects of the TID financing and how we stand with that. And then also we had a discussion about potential additional projects in TID 7, which is down in the Old Town area. Specifically in regard to the extension of the bike trails. Aaron, do you have any further comments?
Yeah, the current status of the bike trail extension, it's a group of state agencies that are putting out an RFP this summer to get a consultant to do the planning and design work for the trail. One of the things that consultant will be looking at is how the trail would come through the village and hook up with Glacial Drumlin. Whatever route it takes, and we'll have some input on that, but it's going to have some effect on the Old Town area. And given Eller's presentation also at that meeting that there could be some extra revenue in that district, just trying to look ahead and see if there are any projects we could do that could kind of capitalize on having the trail there, whether it's directional signage or bike racks or something more extensive, like maybe a facade program down there. Just starting the discussion at this point.
Thank you. Any other questions? 10E, Deer Grove EMS Commission. I think this was a carryover from last meeting, and it may have to come back, but do we have to officially table it, Lee?
Are you going to bring it back, or is it?
We need to get more information from the chief.
I would just table it then, yeah.
Okay. I will discuss and consider Deer Grove EMS special event services fee. I will move to table that item till we get more information from Chief Urshan. Is there a second?
Second.
Motion second to table Deer Grove EMS special event fees until we get more information from Chief Urshan. Any questions, discussion? I'm hearing none. All in favor of tabling? Say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Otherwise, Deer Grove EMS. run fees are approximately 12,000 behind last year, but they're 12,000 above where we were in 14, so they're kind of averaging out a little bit. Run calls through May were just, what'd they say, a dozen less?
Yes.
But June has been a busy month for them, they said. So, we did approve at the prior meeting, we approved a rate increase for volunteers, the LTEs, and we had asked the chief to provide us with some comparisons, which he did. We will be doing a bid for contracting with somebody to write grant proposals for us. There are a lot of grants available, but it takes some special skills to be able to write those grants, and so we're going to try to see if we can find somebody to help us do that.
Harvey, could I just suggest that whoever gets hired also be made aware that there's money in the budget for the EMS attorney to review the strings that we're always concerned about. I think that would be important.
Okay. Yeah, because these would be federal grants, so.
Yeah.
We approved, John, help me remember the discussion about CPR instructors.
Oh, the adjusting the pay rate for CPR discussion or CPR instructors in order for them actually to get paid something that was reasonable, because they were struggling to find individuals that were able to do it when the demand continues to increase. So they only had a few folks that were volunteering, and part of the issue was that the compensation. So, and since the citizens are asking for it, and they're definitely not losing money on these courses, the decision was to certainly bump those up so we can get volunteers to actually run them from the district.
Thank you. There was considerable discussion about the discussions going on with consolidation, regionalization of the EMS services. We instructed Chief Urshan to come back to the commission and provide us with, for lack of a better term, hard numbers of what 2015 would have looked like if the services had been combined. And eventually they're going to want some direction from the various boards on whether or not to continue this process. So that's an item that we need to be thinking about and giving John and I some directions to go back to the commission with, go back to the chief.
Just to clarify, this is with Marshall, the potential of expanding and taking over service for that village.
And so. related townships.
Yeah.
We did some work with updating the job description for the chief, and then we talked about some goals for the chief in closed session. So, that's John, did I miss anything?
Don't believe so. Covered it well.
10F, Emergency Government Committee.
We've got a meeting that's coming on the first Wednesday of July. There's been nothing. We went over that at the last meeting, if I recall.
Okay. So,
no update.
Okay. Number 11, reports from village officers. Troy?
Another report.
Kyle?
No report.
Alex is gone. Jennifer is gone. No report from me. John?
The only thing I would say is I think that the Firemen's Festival seemed to be a success, it looked like to me. The fireworks were well received on Saturday evening. I don't know how attendance was or anything like that, but I know that for the Lions breakfast on Sunday morning, we did have a nice bump in the number of folks that took advantage of having pancakes and such. So I think it was enjoyable.
Is there any special training you had to go through to be mixing that?
Army training, sir.
Chief, any public safety related issues with the festival this year?
No, we had two of our part-timers were assigned there both nights. Temporarily had to pull them off Saturday night to help with a search warrant, but no big issues. People seem to be using the Safe Ride taxis. That worked out well. The parade went okay. I think we might need to discuss the length of it for the color guards and elderly that need to walk in it. But that's a different issue for a different time. And the run went just fine. Seemed to have enough people out there for all the intersections. I didn't hear any complaints about that.
Thanks.
Jack is gone. Attorney Lee Boucher.
John DeYoung will be at our, I think it's August 1st meeting to discuss the income.
Thank you. Administrator Matt Giese.
No report.
Director of Planning and Development, Aaron Ruth.
No report.
Chief Labor.
We made an arrest in the burglary cases that started about 6 days ago. Subject lives in Cottage Grove, lived in the neighborhood where he was committing the burglaries. We recovered almost all of the things that were stolen from the subject's basement and used various techniques to figure out which house it was, including witnesses and dogs and location devices on things that were stolen. So all worked out pretty nicely. The same house that we had the same, 9 months ago where 3 ounces of heroin was seized too. That's it.
Okay, thank you.
Dan, thanks for sharing updates. I know that I've had a number of public people come up to me and tell me that they're tuning in just to watch for updates from you. So and thank you for sharing.
Chief issued a press release as well that's making the rounds.
Yeah, is the best way to get this out by sending it out on Facebook and then doing a press release? Should I add the village board members to the, or are you guys already on Facebook as friends of the police department?
I think both is great.
Okay.
So.
And Chief, I think your message about locking up doors and everything else it still holds true.
Yes.
Number 12, communications and miscellaneous business. Consider approval of vouchers.
I have.
It was the Badger's popcorn.
Yep, that's Rick. That's for concessions.
Oh,
at North Lawn.
Right. I'll motion to approve as presented.
Second.
Motion and a second to approve village portion of the vouchers of $67,882.79. Any further discussion?
I've got one item question.
Okay.
For the items that we're buying from Vinny's Auto or whatever, is there a village resource for that or village place that we can use? Because Vinny's is in the town, right? We do have. I don't know if we have a special agreement with that vendor or not. I'm just curious because I was thinking about, you know, Cottage Grove first, and then I was thinking about folks that are paying taxes in the village versus those that are paying in the town. We can take advantage of a vendor in town. I don't know if we can for these items.
Yeah.
Well, for the police cars, that's where they were taking them when I got here, so we just continued with that.
Okay.
But we certainly could go to Meineke, and isn't there one other one that does vehicle repairs?
I don't know. That's why I'm throwing it out there. I don't know if it's, if we have certain agreement.
I'm not sure.
I'm not sure why we go there, but I will look into it and get back to you guys.
Is anything writing?
No, not at all. I think we can choose who we want, but I don't know what this historical reason was.
I was curious. I don't know.
Motion and a second to approve the vouchers as presented. Any further discussion? And hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Was there any correspondence?
No.
Future agenda items?
The various ordinances that I mentioned.
Okay.
There'll be a carryover on your EMS special event. It'll appear back on the agenda. And if anybody thinks of any ordinances that you want the board to consider, we'll have about a month between meetings. So let us know and we'll add them to the list.
At this time, I will make a motion for the Village of Cottage Grove Village Board to enter into closed session pursuant to Wisconsin State Statutes 1985-1E, deliberating or negotiating the purchase of public property, investing in public funds, conducting other specified business whenever competitive and or bargaining reasons require a closed session, and pursuant to Wisconsin State Statute 1985-1G, conferring with legal counsel for governmental body who is rendering oral or written advice concerning strategy to be adopted by the body with respect to litigation in which it is or is likely to become involved. Legal ramifications of Deer Grove EMS joint agreement, discuss response to latest conditions imposed by the town relating to village application to install and maintain a water main extension on Gaston Road, negotiate terms of for potential development in TID number 6 by Horizon Development Group. Is there a second?
Second.
Yeah.
Just before you vote, there won't be a discussion of EMS. There will be just a brief comment on Horizon, and there will be a brief discussion on the conditions imposed by the town.
Okay. Roll call vote. Troy?
Aye.
Kyle?
Aye.
John?
Aye.
Harvey, yes. We are in closed session.